So,
there you go.
You let me know when you're ready, Kendall.
I'm ready.
All right.
Can we take a look at Randy's stickers?
Hey, everybody, come up here.
Come on.
I am not going up there.
Come on.
Do you want this on camera?
Yeah, we want this on camera. Everybody look at Randy's really cool sneakers.
Oh, sneakers.
Do they light up?
Yeah.
Jump up and down.
It looks like he's done this before.
And he said he didn't want to.
And he said he didn't
want to. That's all you're getting out of me.
Hey, if you do it, you go all out.
I'm all in, man.
That's right.
That's right.
Thank you, Mark. You have our full attention now.
That doesn't look like tonight's topic. That title doesn't match what you sent me.
No, it will eventually.
Okay.
It does.
Okay. So, thanks everybody for coming out tonight. I'm going to be in Matthew 28:19, those of you that saw a little advertisement for this. And I will probably only be there. There might be a few other places I go, and I'm probably lying. But that's my plan. My plan is to kind of stay here and see what happens. But oftentimes, the reason why I have the question up on the board that I started out with here is because I think this is a question a lot of us do ask ourselves. I know it's funny to have it up there, but how many of you have recently, or at least at some point in time in your life that was kind of a critical time, asked the Lord, what is it? Why? Why am I here? What are you doing?
Right?
What are you doing here? Are you cold?
No, I just can't see.
Are you in pain?
Yeah. She killed me. I'm good. Keep going.
She's pre-workout.
She's going to be a little distracting. I'm the only one that can see her, and it's distracting, just so you know. So, I like asking these kinds of questions, like, why do we believe? Remember that? A couple months ago, we asked, why do we believe? And we had a really good discussion around that. But, you know, I really, as a leader, just as a son of God, but also as a leader, I like to kind of ask some of these big, open-ended questions to the Lord, because sometimes we can get so caught up in the little stuff or in the disappointments of life that we forget, what is the bigger picture? What is the purpose? Why are we here? I mean, is it really just about getting saved and going to heaven? Don't get me wrong. I can't wait. The only thing better than dying and going to heaven is Jesus coming back before I die.
Yeah.
That's the only thing better for me. Because I can't wait to see what truly the heavenly dimension is like.
Yeah.
With no limitations.
Yeah.
With all of the freedom that was originally designed for us. Yeah. But only thing better than that is actually to see that here.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's
come on.
That's it.
That's what we want.
Yeah.
So, I think that's what we're doing here. I think that we should be yearning, burning for what we want to be a part of. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with, like, Paul saying, all right, I'm ready to give up this earthly tent and be with the Lord. Okay, he did. He said that several times in the New Testament. But I think the only thing better than that would be to do that here. And so, everything about us should be wanting to bring that which we can't wait to enjoy into this realm. Because that was the original intention when he made man.
Yeah.
I think that was the original environment. We talked about this before, those of you that were here for that lesson where I talked about where's heaven. God always designed heaven to be on earth. That was always the plan. He even says it in Genesis 1. He says he caused the birds of the air to fly where? Anybody remember? In the expanse of heaven. And I've always asked I asked this classic question, have you ever had a bird fly by your head?
have it sit on my head.
Have you ever had a poop on your windshield?
On my shoulder.
Okay, that's heaven. The air was the heavens. That was the original atmosphere of the earth. So the goal that I believe when he tells the disciples to pray, let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's what it's about. It's about bringing everything that God had always designed for man to have here. And for him to enjoy man in the fullness of relationship right here. Okay, so after Jesus dies and resurrects, he gives this great command, or this commission. Some of you have been called, what's it called in your Bible? You have the Great Commission, right? And if you ask me, this is a really good place to kind of get an idea from the Lord. I think he's the best place to get the answer from of what are we doing here? What are we supposed to be doing here? What are we about? And then on top of this is right before he ascends. This is after he's resurrected. So these are important words. And he says this, Jesus came up and spoke to them in verse 18, saying to them, all authority has been given me in heaven and on earth. Is Megan's not in the room?
Megan, no.
Okay, are you available?
Yes.
Can you write on the board for me? No, not. No. You'll distract everybody in this room. Can you write that verse? It's right across here. All authority in heaven and earth. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Say we have tissues. I have a really bad cold.
On our table.
Oh, that'd be this might not be a recordable night. Oh, I'm messed up.
That's good. I was going to ask you to edit out the first part.
No.
Oh, no. We're keeping the whole shoe.
That's the only thing.
The shoe model.
That's Dave. Dave, man.
Has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Period. Okay. So, the reason why I think there's a couple different reasons why it seems to me that the Lord says that first sentence. First of all, in verse 17, it says some were doubtful. So this is right after the angel appears to Mary and tells them that, hey, he's resurrected, he's risen, he's not in the tomb anymore. Go run into the city and tell the disciples that he'll meet you there. And so he comes, she comes to the disciples and says, hey, I just saw an angel, and the angel said, well, actually, she meets Jesus on the road. And then he says to her to go on and meet him. And some are doubtful at her words. And so he says to them, first off, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. I believe that's a key context for the next verse. So I looked up the word all, and it is, you know, I just have to remind you guys of this, that it's all. There is no authority that is not Jesus's. None.
Awesome.
Yeah. Just think about that for a second. No authority that's not Jesus's. So any earthly governor you can think of, president, boss, policeman, evil spirit, all of that authority is Jesus' authority. Just wrap your head around that if you can for a second. There is no authority on the planet, in heaven, anywhere. That's not Jesus. So all the laws of gravity, all the scientific laws of thermodynamics, they're all his. He created them all. They're all in his hand. Which means if you want to operate supernaturally, if you want to operate spiritually, if you want to operate in power and in authority, we probably ought to be hanging out with him. The more you are with the one who has all authority, what do you think you're going to get?
Understanding.
Yeah. And also the understanding of how to operate in it.
Exactly.
Because he doesn't just willy-nilly just do whatever he wants with his authority. No, he still operates in this level of order where all of this incredible design, not only just the human body, but the earth in general, still operates beautifully. I mean, think about for how many generations the sun comes up when it's supposed to, and sets when it's supposed to. We know when winter starts and when summer starts and all that. All of that is by his authority. That is amazing to me. When you start wrapping your head around all of these things that we call laws, whether they're natural man-made or whether it's natural, you know, of the earth and creation, it's all under his authority. All authority has been given to me. So someone gave Jesus this authority. And we have to know that's the Father. Okay, the Father gives Jesus this authority. And we know later on in Revelation, Jesus gives it all back to him. He hands it back over to the Father, and then we all together with him enjoy the rule and reign of this creation that he's given us. So all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. I think that's an important pairing. I think it goes back to our original idea that we talked about in the beginning that says that heaven and earth were made to be one. I don't think heaven is this separate, faraway place. I think Jesus pairs these together purposefully to let man know, guys, what I'm about to tell you is all about heaven and earth. It's about a joining of these two. I mean, think about this. If they could have asked, when they asked him to, how do we pray?
Yeah.
Out of all the things he could have told them. I mean, let's talk about that prayer for a second before we go on to the next verse.
Yeah.
So what's that prayer? Our Father, who is in heaven. He lives in heaven. Think about that. There's a reason why he said that. Who art in heaven. Who dwells in heaven, whose throne is the place of heaven. We know that the earth is his footstool. Heaven is his throne, earth is his footstool. Alright, so our Father, who dwells, who is in heaven, holy or hallowed, if you're King Jamesy, is your name. Okay? Which means to be revered, to be honored, to be respected, even to be feared. What's the next verse? Your kingdom come. So, this king, who is the Father,
right,
is in heaven.
Uh-huh.
Jesus tells his disciples, as a son, Jesus is a son, tells his disciples, who are eventually going to become his friends, and later on we find out it's the brethren. Okay? So, it's his brothers. He says, brothers, my Father, he's holy. He's awesome. He's worthy of your reverence, worthy of your... all the things that we talked about in the Old Testament, he's worthy of all those things. He lives in heaven. Now, let's ask him for his kingdom to come. And all the will. Because don't forget, heaven is the place where his will has no resistance. It's freely governing. Oh. Just saying those words just makes me want to cry thinking about no resistance, no limitation to the governance of God, to what he wants to happen. His will, his decided desires concerning man have no limitation in the heavenly realm. So Jesus says, guys, let's ask Dad that everything about his kingdom, which is the foundation of power, Basilia, and all that he wants to have happen, that's happening in the heavenly dimension, let's ask him for it to be here.
Yes.
Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done.
On earth.
He's in heaven. He's in heaven.
Yes.
He lives there. He dwells there. But he doesn't just want to hang out there. It's just like, look, I sleep in my bedroom, but I don't live there. Even technically, I live there probably half my life. But I live my life somewhere else. The throne is the place from which the power emanates, but it's not the only place of the kingdom. It has to have a place where it establishes, where it has credence, where it makes sense, where it has the freedom to roam and be what it was created to be. That's this. So he's in heaven, but Jesus asks him, could you make it part of the earth again? That's what the Lord's Prayer is all about. Out of all the things they could have prayed, that's it. My daddy's in heaven, and he wants to be here. All of my daddy's desires, all of his plans, all of his purposes had to be pulled out because the king of this world took the authority from man that God gave to him. Now let's get it back. Now I'm going to do my part, Jesus says this. I'm going to break the power that he had, that man gave him. I'm going to reestablish it and restore it to Julia and everybody else in this room. Give it back to the rightful owners. And then we're going to do this again. You and me together this time.
Yeah.
You lost it without me. Now we're going to get it back together.
Yes.
That's the plan here. And so after he resurrects, he says to his disciples, guys, remember what I taught you to pray? All right, I got all the authority back.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
I got it all back. Remember when I told you that you had the keys of the kingdom? All right, you got the keys, I got the power.
Yeah.
What else do you need?
Yeah.
I got it all.
Yeah.
All the authority and all the power in heaven and on earth together are mine. Now, let's do something. What are we doing here? This is what we're doing here. Verse 19. Go. That's the first word, go. So what I did was I'm looking up every word in the Greek in this verse. Is that okay?
Sure.
Gonna, except for some of the is, a's.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so go. And it, actually the go ye or go you is all one word. So go in the original language has to be applied to something. It can't just be go. So it's go you, go ye. Okay? And it's the word, I'm not even going to tell you these words, say it because I can't and I'll just mutilate it. But it means to travel. It means to literally leave one place and go to another. He wants us to move. So the very first command, there are so many commands inside this commission. There's multiple ones. It's going to be so much fun to find. The first one is, don't sit in one place. Don't sedate. Don't settle. Don't maintain. I want you to go. I want you to move. Because if the authority that I have, before I go any farther on the word go, let's go back to this. He gives us this statement so that we are confident in this commission.
Yes.
We have to know that because of this, we can confidently go. It's not like I hope you guys do all right. I hope you guys get it. I hope you have what it takes to do this. That's not it at all. He says, guys, you can have all the confidence in the world. All the confidence in heaven that I have it all. And if you go with me, in me, that's one of the key phrases throughout the New Testament. Be in me. Be a part of what I am and who I am. Then you can have all the confidence that when you go, this goes with you.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you leave your house and go to Giant, if you leave your house and go to work, if you leave your house to go on a missions trip, if you leave your house and go mow your yard, the authority of the King is with you. And then the neighbor, the shopper next to you, the person in the mission field, all gets to experience that verse. Which is verse what? 18. So you traverse, you travel, to depart, to go, to journey, to walk. So this word, okay, can we start writing this now?
Yes.
So this is the next, can you just write 18 here so that we know? And then write Matthew 20. Thanks. I'm learning to have somebody else do that because it's bad when I do it. All right, so next verse is go.
That's 19.
Yeah. Go, therefore. Okay, so write the word therefore. The reason why I love this word that he puts in there is because therefore always relates back to what was said earlier. Okay? So that's why this go makes sense. Because the therefore, okay, I have a pen second. The therefore refers back to this. Go therefore, be happy, be joyous, be confident. Go therefore. Why? Go because I have all authority given to me in heaven and in earth. That's why you go. Don't go because you think you're cool.
Right.
Don't go because you want to see every nation on the planet. Don't go because it would be really cool to go see other nations. Guys, that is not the reason to go. If you just have a desire or a bug to travel, you better get that thing under control, or you're going to go in your own strength and in your own flesh. There's a reason to go. There's a therefore in this verse. Get it under control of this verse, and the world opens up. Please, hear this. Go therefore. Why? Because you need to go because I'm going back to my dad. Remember that guy that I told you to pray to bring heaven to earth? I'm going back to him. I need you now to be me. So, Ephesians 1:21, just write this one down because you'll need that later. I want to get it exactly right. I think it's 1:21. So, let me just read the context here because Ephesians just rocks. Like, I don't even know where to start. There's so much good stuff in Ephesians that I want to start at a certain verse, but I want to keep going up to get the context of it. It's so incredible that you will know that the hope of his calling is. What are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? That's 18. What is the surpassing greatness of what? His power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might. All authority has been given to me, which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him where? At his right hand in the heavenly places. This is Paul talking about his dad and what he did in Christ. So he's at the right hand in the heavenly places. Jesus is far above. How above?
Far.
Far above, which means like not close. Not like way. Like, really big distance, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion. Let's add a couple extra words in case you guys doubt that he has all power and all authority. And every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. Just in case you're wondering, even in the later ones. Even after this Old Testament thing is all done and we're fully walking in the kingdom, he has authority there too. And above every name. Verse 22. And he put how many things under his feet?
All things.
That's the same word. All things are under his feet. Please do not think anything that you face is not under his feet.
Amen. That's right.
And gave him, Jesus, as head over
all
things. It's just... I just get so excited about this, it hurts. To the church. So what's said next is now about us. Mm-hmm. And what is that? We are his body. And we are the
fullness.
Whoa.
That's great.
Oh. He is no longer full without us. We are the finish of him. We are the fullness. He is not complete. He is not himself anymore without us. He can't be who he is. So that's why this verse starts to just blow my brain. Because now this is said not just about Jesus. Because we are his body. Look, if I shake your hand, who shook your hand? Say it.
You.
Who's me?
Mark.
No, my hand shook your hand. No, who shook her hand?
Mark did.
Mark did. But what's the only thing touching her hand?
Your hand.
Well, then how is Mark shaking her hand? It's just my hand shaking her hand.
An extension of you.
It's an extension of me. When I reach out and touch her with my hand, it's Mark doing it. The whole of me is reaching out to her. When Jesus sends us, it's him sending himself. When we touch the world, he does. There's no disconnect. There's no, it's just my hand. The rest of me doesn't like you. You get me? Yeah. We are him. I mean, later on in 1 John 4:17, it says, just as he is, so also are we.
In the earth.
I'm repeating things you already know, so it gets pressed in. That you're not just this Sinner saved by grace that can't wait to go to heaven. That is not what this earthly existence is about. There is something so much better.
When the grammar there punctuates that in high school, and you break down sentences and you find the subject and the
please.
Verb. Sorry.
Yeah.
When you find the subject and the verb go, there is the verb, the assumed subject of that is you. So it's literally saying, all authority has been given to me, therefore you. It's literally.
Yeah, and that's why the Greek word is go you.
Go you.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go.
Come on.
Even grammar fits.
I bet math even works there, but let's not do that.
All right, so, who's going?
He is.
Great answer. You said you and you said Jesus, and they're both right. Yeah, I mean, there's hundreds of places where I could go in the New Testament and show us that when we go, he goes. What's that famous verse in John, at the end of John, right after he resurrects? Just as the Father sent me, so I send you. Everything the Father sent Jesus to do, we're to do. So he, through Jesus, was reconciling the world to himself. So what's God doing through us? Same thing.
One of the biggest things I see, and it just kind of kicked here, is we should say, go me. Because if we go ahead and say you, we always like the you. You go.
Somebody else go.
Yeah.
Ooh. And it's we go ahead and do it personal, it's me. I need to go.
Oh my gosh.
Can I ask over here, is the go physical go or spiritual go? Does it punctuate that or no? Does it? Sorry. Is it saying spiritually go or is it saying physically go? Like travel, move,
or both?
Like much?
Yes,
both.
Okay, that's what it is.
Sure. So, didn't Paul travel in the spirit to the places where he would visit physically?
Yes.
Right.
When I pray for a nation, I go there. Yeah. I think when you think about prayer, you realize that it becomes translation. Where I can actually pray for the nation of Ukraine, and my spirit does not stay here. My spirit goes there. How else can I feel what they're feeling? Be able to intercede properly is because my spirit actually goes there. That's why this. When you think about the heavenly dimension, you realize it's not limited to time and space like our physical body is.
Yep.
Where
is it?
So when I pray, when you pray for whoever, maybe it's your friend in another place, more likely than not, if they're as sensitive as you could be, they'll know when you're there.
Same spirit.
Yeah, go spirit, go natural.
Same spirit.
Yeah.
But
yes.
I don't think, I don't think we ought to just send missionaries spiritually.
No.
All right,
no.
Maybe Diane, I'm just going to send you spiritually and we're going to go win souls.
Right.
No, we have to physically
faith.
Get there and go.
Uh-huh.
We've got to do that. We have to go in this command, not, I really want to go see Africa. No, if you really want to go see Africa, then you're probably just going to get something.
It's a vacation.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of missionaries that just want to go to go. Then there's something else deeper on the inside of you that says, no, I want to go because. I want to go because I'm him. He is me. And I want to reconcile the world to my Father, to my Savior. Okay.
Talking about people, knowing that you're there. My friend Debbie was doing an appraisal on the house in the neighborhood, and she was leaving. And she said this little black lady walked up to her, and she said, what you doing here? And she said, I'm doing an appraisal. She said, well, can you people in my house? She said, well, I'll have to wait and see and get the comps and let you know. So the lady said, oh, so you like to praise. You're like from Judah. So they went through this whole thing, and the lady said, I want you to raise your hands up. We just right in the middle of the street. She said, I want you to pray. She said, you worry about your brother-in-law who's in the hospital. She said, yes, I am. And my sister's not speaking to me, and I can't go see him. I'm trying to hurry through this. And the lady said, it's going to be okay. So they prayed, and Debbie went home. And next day, her sister called her. They got reconciled. Debbie went to the hospital to see her brother-in-law. And the brother-in-law says, I saw you and that little black nurse praying for me up there at the foot of my bed. Because the lady was all dressed in white. And that's why Karen says, you don't have a black nurse. And he says, I saw her and Debbie at the foot of my bed praying.
You went there?
She, my friend, yeah, Debbie and the Lord, they went there. Debbie went back to appraise the woman's house, the address that she gave her, she knocked on the door, and they said, there's nobody here by that name. Oh, I'm telling you.
Wow.
Awesome.
Well, I love it.
I was just kind of wondering, I'm a little confused about something. I know that in intercessory prayer, God had given me like a real cute, clear vision of a man named Bob with a pistol to his head and said, this is how you pray. And I was obedient, and then I prayed. I think I'm kind of wondering why God just didn't bring that person there to it. Like, why do I need to go to where, I don't even know where it was that I was supposed, the guy is or was, is. Why didn't he just bring someone there without me having to pray, God bring such and such to him?
I don't know.
Okay.
Sure, you got a better answer.
Most of the time with intercessory prayer, it's for you.
Yeah.
It's your heart that needs to be changed.
Yeah.
Okay, whenever you're doing that, you're in touch with Jesus, understanding you're in a doorway, you're in that situation, so that your heart, your perspective will go ahead and open up so many other things.
Mm-hmm. So are you saying that it was God did that for me, or
it,
that I was interceding for that man?
That changes your life completely. Whenever you start asking questions, whenever you're doing this,
totally.
It changes your life, because now you're in the spirit realm seeing so many things,
mm-hmm.
that so many doors just open up, so it changes your heart completely
mm-hmm.
towards people.
So
very much so.
So he was using it, I know
mm-hmm.
this is all kind of stuff.
As a learning opportunity.
But as a learning opportunity, mm-hmm. but at the same time, wasn't it for his benefit as well?
Yes, sure. Very much so.
Mm-hmm. So.
Two things at the same time. Right.
So it's like a two-way
mm-hmm.
kind of thing.
It's a win-win situation.
Bless and be blessed kind
mm-hmm.
of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right, next word. So you probably have most of your versions. Go, therefore, and make disciples. Is that what most of you have there?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Can you write that?
Mm-hmm.
Teach. Leave my wonderful, pretty arrows, okay? Yeah. That word, King James, if anybody still uses that here, which I hope you don't. But if you do, do you want to see it?
Well, do you want me to?
No, just so far what I'm writing. So, and make disciples. Okay. Just uses the word teach. But I love the idea of make disciples, because it much better fits the Greek word, which means, where it said, matheteu. Sorry, I told you I wouldn't be saying these things. I should stop. And the word actually means to become a pupil or a disciple or to enroll as a scholar.
Matheteu.
See that again? Thank you. Okay. So, I like this idea, because it says the idea of teaching them is not really what the word means. It means to make them a learner. Think about this. How many times have we talked about here that the real teacher is not the guy behind the pulpit? It's really the person of the Lord. And so we go, we're not going and teaching them. We're going and making them learned ones. Ones that will learn from Him. It means to become or to make them a pupil, disciple, or scholar. One who is learning. So when we think about Jesus' 12 disciples, they are ones who were learning of the Lord. They were His disciples. John had disciples. They were learning of John. But then once Jesus shows up, a lot of John's disciples stop following John and start following Jesus. And John's like, sup? And other people are wondering, why do John's disciples do this, but your disciples don't? And think about that. Think about two different sets of disciples at the same time. One's following John and one's following Jesus. Now, it's so new that people are probably still like, what's up? Maybe, gosh, 50, 7,500 years later, there's still that going on. But the idea of a disciple is someone who is learning from. So when we are going in this authority, we're going to make, create, not... See, that's what I love. It's not setting people free. That sounds like the right thing to say. Like we're setting them free from their sin. But this is going to be a little hard to say here, so I just need you to receive this. Jesus already did that. So let's not do what Jesus already did. Let's cause them to become aware of the freedom that's already theirs.
Right.
Yeah.
Does that sound better?
Yeah.
Okay? Now, we know that in Isaiah, Jesus says that we've come to set the captive free. But who came to do that?
Jesus.
Jesus did, okay? There's some of the work that when he said it is finished, is finished. It's not work that we have to do over again. Remember how we talked about spiritual warfare? The majority of what we call spiritual warfare is really just us boxing shadows, because the reality is it's already done.
Yeah.
Okay? So the setting the captive free is finished in the cross and resurrection of Jesus. What we're called to do is to not set people free from their sin. He's done that. Mm-hmm. What we're called to do is to make them aware of who he is and what he's already done. That changes perspective a little bit. Now, when I go, again, whether it's next door or across the world, I go to make people aware of the work Jesus has already accomplished. Now let's think about, for a second, what it is that he's accomplished. What is it that when we're done making them a disciple, they're going to become aware of? Let's just talk about it for a second.
Make disciples.
Come on. Yeah, I'm going to have to be careful here. We'll just do this here. What are they becoming aware of as a disciple? You tell me.
The authority.
Okay, the authority. Yep.
If you don't mind, I'm going to write this.
Kingdom.
Okay, another one.
They're forgiven.
They're forgiven.
True identity?
Their identity. They get to find out that they're not orphans. That they're not these broken, horrible creatures that have no future or no hope. They're sons and daughters. That God actually thought this all along. You just didn't know. But let me make you aware of who you really are. You actually knew this at one time. But then you forgot. So you're going to have to unlearn what you aren't and relearn what you are.
That's right.
That's renewing the mind.
That's renewing the mind. Thank you. Anything else?
Sorry. Healed? Has it been healed?
Oh, healed. Yeah. So, healed. Let's go ahead and write set free. Because all of these things are done. Okay? These are done deals. When we talk about the finished work of Jesus, we realize that we don't have nearly as much to do as we thought we did. The more I'm really beginning to apply the finished work of Jesus to me, my life becomes simpler and simpler and simpler. I realize now that my main job is to be light. And as I'm light, you come, I know you already know this, but just pretend you don't. As I come, my light reveals who you really are, who he really is, and then you in turn get to turn around and just be light. I don't have to work really hard at this. Most of the work is done in here. It's the transformation process. It's the renewing of our mind that Kendall talked about. That's the majority of the Christian life, is overcoming flesh with spirit so that more light shines out of darkness. Is that okay?
People will even reject that.
Oh, they will. If they rejected Jesus, they're going to reject our light. That's for sure.
Yeah, go ahead. People just overcomplicate it.
We do.
Maybe they need to walk around and save the world.
Yep.
And they're already saved.
Yep.
That's good.
That's the gospel, guys.
Yeah.
That sounds like universalism, and it's not.
Right.
This is a finished work. They are already saved. They have to reject what has been offered them.
It's true. I mean, they've already been saved. Jesus saved them when he died on the cross. They're already saved. They just need to realize it. And then they have the choice to say, yes, I'm saved, or
that's the beginning of being a disciple. The realization, oh my goodness, I'm free. And then a progressive walking out that freedom until it becomes a reality in your life. Did you want to say something about it?
Yeah, I think about that verse, you know, that he already says, like, the greatest command, love your neighbor.
We're about to get there.
Oh,
that's great. No, 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 keep talking.
No, but I think it's a love issue. When we have trouble with other people, it reflects, because Scripture says, love them as you love yourself.
Right.
So if you're having trouble with other people, it really comes back to an
inner
territory issue.
Yes.
With all of this stuff.
That is why the majority of your battle is in here.
That's right.
We always try to put it outside of ourselves. It's not. That is a finished one WON work.
Well, when you say disciples, I'm trying to marry that with our talk about discipline a couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
Because to me, the pupil aspect of it has an inherent quality of that to it, where your teacher both instructs you, but also...
Yep.
That make disciples to me is kind of a...
It's a process.
Yeah. The finished work is existing, but also the partnership of the process.
If we realize that discipline is actually removing everything you aren't to reveal everything you are, if we can just remember that that is the most basic concept of discipline. Mm-hmm. Parents, if you're going to discipline your kids, do it this way. Remove every behavior, every belief, every action, remove it from them so they can reveal who they really are. Discipline is pointing out that's not who you are. This is who you are. That's discipline. When you realize that, now it's not about punishment, even though there is some of that in there so they can be reminded. It's much more about a reminding. It's about who they are. You want
to
say something?
It goes back to your standards and your rules.
Yeah. Right.
Same because thing. Discipline is a governmental thing if you go ahead and take a look at that, or it can be a loving thing as like a father.
Right, okay, got that. Excellent.
Hey, Mark.
Yeah.
I was thinking too, when you're talking about making disciples, that it's not just knowing our own identity, but knowing the truth of who the Father is. Because if you don't know, if you don't really get the truth of the Father, who he really is, you're not going to understand identity, you're not going to understand the forgiven.
Absolutely.
Part of it.
That's who we know who we are. We realize who he is, what he's done, why he's done it. Let's think about it. Why did he die for us? Why?
Because he loves us.
So that we would have a relationship with
God. He loved us.
He wanted a family.
He wanted a family. I'm going to say this. He already had a family. He had to set his family free to have the relationship with them he designed for them to have. You're right, Courtney. It's not wrong. It's right. But he had to get... He saw his family trapped. It's the prodigal son.
He's restoring it back to Genesis 2.
Absolutely.
Well, what's crazy is he needed the body.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have a body.
I'm going to say it better. He wanted one.
Excuse me?
Okay.
He wanted one. How did he know it was not good for man to be alone?
Because
he was alone. That's how he knew. Mm-hmm. Even though he had Holy Spirit and Jesus, that's all cool. But he realized, guys, wouldn't it be great to have kids?
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't it be awesome to have this big family that we could all get around the table together and just, you know, have food fights and tell funny stories too and see what they dream about. Isn't that what it's about?
Yeah.
And then that plan goes awry. But they already kind of know it's going to go awry because they make him fragile. They make him good but innocent. And when you put good, innocent things into an environment where it could go either way, they're probably going to get influenced by that realm. And so it did. So Jesus says, you know what, Daddy? Remember, I think we talked about this before. It's worth it. Let's go ahead and make them because I know what I'm going to have to do and it's still worth it. Let's do it anyway. So he dies before the foundation of the world, knowing that he's going to have to do this. And he still makes us. So really, the reality, why did Jesus come? To set Dad's family free.
Well, it says our Father. We were
right. Our Father. It's beautiful.
Diane's doing, I mean, I'm looking at Diane when you're talking about that and thinking about
which part?
Her life. Her life. And she knows she's going to sacrifice, you know that you're going to sacrifice for that life inside of you. You're going to have to. And you know that that beautiful baby's going to trip up and fall and when they're learning to walk and everything else. And you do it anyway. Mm-hmm. And because I just saw, like, man.
So worth it.
Exactly. It's the potential. It's like, man, yeah, that other stuff's going to happen, but holy cow, it's worth it.
So that's the hope that was set before Jesus in Hebrews, where it says, for the hope set before him, I'm going to endure the cross. Mm-hmm. You're going to endure labor because you know what's coming. And not just holding this baby, but you know what this baby is going to become.
Yes.
Mm. Okay, ready for the next phrase? Of all nations. This is awesomeness.
And that all means all.
There's your next video.
I just hear you saying the all quote.
Okay, let's go ahead and write in parentheses above that ethnos. Now we know that this is where we get our word in the English language, ethnic. And it does mean race. But I like what the word race actually means. It means of the same habit. It means groups of people that have the same custom, have the same way of life, that is different than yours. So it actually is telling us, all right, August, you're going to go, and you're going to go somewhere because I have all authority. And when you go, you're going to go and you're going to do this. You're going to make disciples. So the next question that's going to be answered here is where? Well, who am I going to go to? Where am I going to go? And she, you know, he says, all kinds of people that aren't like you. Whoa. I think that's powerful. So we see this really cool example of it in the New Testament. We see this kind of rednecky, risk-taking, doesn't really always think before he acts, Galilean named Peter, who's not necessarily your typical Jew. He's a fisherman. And, you know, by all accounts that I see about him, he doesn't fit like this devout, I got my act together Jew, yet he's the one that gets anointed to reach Jews. And then you've got the Jew who's got all his you-know-what together. He's got all the stuff hanging on the wall at home. He says he was trained at the feet of Gamaliel. He's got all the stuff, all the pedigree, everything. And Jesus says, nope, not the Jews. You're going to the Gentiles. And Paul even says, I got everything. And I want my brethren to come to the Lord. I desire it more than they do. In fact, he even says, you guys remember this? In 1 Corinthians, he says, or Romans 11, I wish that I would be accursed just so that my brethren would see and know what I know. This is the guy that wants his Jewish brothers so much to come to the Lord, and God says, you go to Jews, of Gentiles. You go to people that aren't like you. And he's doing this all the time. I remember the first time I met Dawn and I realized I wasn't leading this area. There was not one plan in my heart or in my parents' heart for me to stay here. Every plan in my heart was as soon as I was done, I am moving to D.C. or to Philly or to New York. Because frankly, I was bigger than this place. That's what I believed. This place was small potatoes. I'm being honest. I gotta get a drink. This is what I believed. It's honestly what my parents had taught me to believe. They never said it. It's just a culture you pick up. You know, you just pick up certain things in your culture. Yeah. Remember? Ethnos is of the same habit. So, without my mom actually saying it, I was kind of looking down on this area. Well, they have a college here. They're offering me a swimming scholarship. So I'm going to go here and I'm going to get my college degree. But then as soon as they say, you're graduated, I'm off. And then I meet a pretty farm girl. Who I can just tell is not super interested in moving away from mom and dad quite yet. You were ready to go off the farm.
Yeah.
You weren't ready to go. You liked the idea of going and coming back. In fact, she was already in the nations ahead of me. She was in Mexico City for a whole, you know, Philadelphia and Mexico City for while I was here for a whole year learning how to be a Christian, which she then taught me. And I realized when I met her, the Lord began talking to me that, no, this, I brought you here not to get a college degree.
I
brought,
this is
the college degree.
Yeah, it was a setup. And he brought me here because this people who was not of my habit, not of my way, or my culture, I'm a New Yorker.
I love it.
All right.
Yeah.
In Reading.
First 10 years of my life, Yonkers, New York.
Oh.
And even though we moved to Reading, we moved New York with us. We traveled back there regularly. My dad still talks like this. And God brought me to this foreign tribe. Honestly, guys, I'm telling you, when we introduced my mom to my, it was hard to accept because they saw me moving on. I understood that. But I know God brought me to this race. When I think about it, He didn't just bring me to Franklin County, rural Pennsylvania. He also brought me to a Mennonite-based culture.
Amen.
I was a heathen. That's my background. My dad made sure that if I went to church with my mom, he was going to be letting me know about it, that he was not happy. So definitely God brought me to an area that was not mine. And I had to learn this culture to reach it. So far, pretty good. It's happening. And this is what's going on. He is causing us to come to make disciples to places that are not our own. So if you are pretty comfortable with your own, you might want to revisit this verse for a while. Because when you get this verse into your spirit, you're going to realize that this could be home for you, but you could be actually called to go to a very different habit of people.
I'm looking up the definitions for the live tweeting, and so I'm on Bible study tools. I got that cool audio for you. One of the other definitions on there says the human family for ethnos. So it's like not just about there's this other people that you're supposed to interact with. No, it's the joining of the family.
Yeah, so we're bringing the family together.
Yeah.
So Mark, that's right along what I was thinking.
That's great.
Jesus is the King of Nations, okay?
Yeah.
So there's aspects of him in all those nations that he knows about, but we don't know about. And so really, as we go, we learn more of him. We experience more of him.
Right.
So that's why when we go out, rather than, like, say, we're taking something there that they don't have, rather to go and say we're looking to find him, like we don't know him
right here.
And so to me, that's just kind of a reassuring, and it goes back to all authority in heaven and earth.
Right. He also specifically was telling them non-Jews. That's what the word ethnos, when they heard Jesus say to go to all ethnos, he was specifically saying, don't just go to Jews. Even me, when I was here, I even said, I was not sent for you. I was sent for the lost tribe of Israel, lost sheep of Israel. Now, it's not the case anymore. Now it's everybody. Remember that promise my daddy gave to Abraham? And all the nations of the earth will be blessed in him. This is it. This is it right here. Don't shy away from anyone. Go to all of them. No prejudice. If you want to talk about a verse where there's no prejudice, no judgments anymore, this is it. And it's not just about different races. It's different ways of life. Mm-hmm. It's different belief systems. It says, one of the other words here is pagans. Pagan was just a simple term that meant people that don't believe in Yahweh, to the Jew. So, you know, these were practices that, you know, so the homosexual needs to be made a disciple. The alcoholic, the drug addict, the terrorist, the, you know, elite government official who doesn't think he needs God, the rich man, all of them. Those are all ethnos.
Pagans don't see themselves as pagans.
Right. So far, so good? So, we know where to go, we know what we're going to do when we go, and we're going to know where we're going. And there's no limitation to where you're going. I know some people have said that they feel a specific call to a specific people or a specific nation. And there are times for that. I don't think, though, you're going to find a lot of scriptural backing for Joey's call to Cuban people. There's not a lot of scriptural emphasis for that. There's much more of an emphasis of, no, he's called to go. There might be a season of time where he's called to establish something in Cuba. There's another time where he might be called to establish something in Hagerstown, Maryland. Mm-hmm. And then another time, somewhere else. You guys hear that?
Yeah.
So be careful not to pigeonhole yourself. Oh, I'm definitely called to Africa. Oh, I am called to Africa. No, actually, you're called everywhere. Feel free to go to Africa. Feel free. No. Buy tickets, go, be Jesus. Okay. Other people are just nothing. Yeah.
I find out most of the time is where you don't want to go.
Possibly. Right? That's true. Yeah, those are some of the ethnos. Baptizing them.
Is this still mine?
Yep. So, just write baptizing them and leave that. This is where it gets kind of interesting. Now, I can say this word. I'm good. It's baptizo. Okay, the Z actually sounds like a DZ. Baptizo. And it means to immerse, to submerge, to make overwhelmed.
Yeah.
I love that. Can we just not think of this in terms of water for a second? For a couple minutes. Maybe 15 minutes. And think of this in terms of simply being immersed and submerged and overwhelmed in what he's about to say next. Don't think of water. Think of, I'm going to get immersed and submerged and overwhelmed by something. But could it be more than, I'm supposed to be taking Kendall and dunking him in water and saying three names after that? Could it be more than that? Could it be that the whole reason why every ethnos needs to see me and experience me is so they can really be fully immersed, fully overwhelmed, fully submerged? I mean, like, no part of you isn't touched by this thing. Is it possible that we've then just related it to this ceremonial act? Just possible. I think it also has to do with literal physical baptism, okay? Don't get me wrong. But I gotta wonder, Jesus is not always as practical as we think he is. I think he's also talking in very real terms here. Even though it's spiritual terms, they're very real to him because real and spirit are the same to him. Okay? So next phrase, baptizing them in, you guys know this, I don't have to say it, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That word name is the word anoma. It's a derivative of another word here. Give me just a second. Oh, it's a derivative of the word to know. Ginosko. I'm not going to make you go look there. But it's a derivative of the word to know. So, it's not just saying the name. Remember how Jesus would say, whatever you pray to my Father and ask in my name, Now, we've all taken that to mean every time you pray, make sure you say afterwards,
right,
or it doesn't stick.
Right.
If you just say amen, oh, that was a waste. He didn't hear it. I mean, really, is that what Jesus meant when he says, if you're going to ask him my name? No, it's the same phrase here. It means to be in knowledge of Jesus. Onoma. It means to be understood by. It means to understand and be known in and by and to know this person, the name that you're saying, the name. So, is it possible that we're not baptizing and saying names? Is it that we're getting submersed in the knowledge of, in the understanding of, in the familiarity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Yeah, the culture of the environment. If we start thinking of it not in terms of, but in terms of when I am in your presence, my job, my reason for living is to bring you into a greater understanding of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As you are with me, my role is to overwhelm you, submerge you in one of these three identities. When you're with me, you're going to experience Papa. Who he is, what he says, how it feels. Have you ever had someone leave you and say, I just feel like I was with Jesus? Or at least someone say, you know what? You told me what the Lord would tell me. Or I heard the Lord tell me that just the other day. Someone can might even say to you, I just like when you're around. You just make me feel better. I feel more alive. I like your presence. I think it's because we are submersing them in this theme, in this knowledge, in this understanding of. And then as we do that, they become disciples. What do you think? Is it possible? Is it possible he's not telling us to go all around and make sure we've got bathtubs nearby? What happens if we're in a desert? How do you baptize somebody?
Dry cleaning.
Look, I get it. If you go into the New Testament, you see that they all want to be baptized. A lot of that comes from the fact that John was baptizing people. It's ceremonial. I can promise you this. If you get saved and die before you're baptized, I can promise you you're still going to be in heaven. Because this jailer, when the earthquake happened, Paul told him, just believe in the name. That was it. So baptism, yes, I think it's great. I think everybody should be baptized. It'd be great. But if you're not, I think there's a greater baptism.
Yes.
I think there's a real baptism that Jesus is talking about here. And it's in the knowledge and familiarity and understanding of these three wonderful, incredible personalities, natures of God.
Yes.
That this is the point. This is why we go. Because when we're not with them and they're just in their ignorance walking around not as disciples but as lost sheep, that's what they're called, then they don't have the privilege of being immersed. All they have is Holy Spirit being upon them, convicting them concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment. That's what Jesus promised will be going on in the life of someone who does know the Lord. That's why they need us. Are they without excuse? Yes. They can look at creation, look at themselves, and see, oh my goodness, somebody other than a Big Bang made this. Absolutely. That's pretty obvious. But that's all I know. And then Angie shows up. And as she's with them, it's not just about Pinterest and all these other worldly things. No, it becomes about being immersed in the presence and person of the Lord. And as I'm with Angie, I begin to not just feel, but experience, know natures of the Godhead. It's an intentional going. So even when you're hanging out with someone, even when you're sitting with them at work, and yes, you're doing work here and they're doing work there, there's still an intentionality about, while I'm here, is really, yes, I'm doing a job, and yes, my employer needs me to get this job done, but there's a greater reason why I'm here.
Yeah.
While I'm picking orders, or when I'm typing my email, whatever it is, there is an immersion that I need to make sure is intentionally taking place around me. That's what go and therefore means. And don't forget, this baptizo, has all authority attached to it. So don't think, I'm not a really good witness. I'm kind of weak in this. I don't. You just need to make a decision to go. And if you go, therefore comes with you. And now when you're in school, Brent, you're baptizing your kids every day. You can, if you want to pour water on them, go ahead. It makes you feel better. But the reality is, you're baptizing them because you're there. But it's not just because you're there. No, you are intentionally going. You're in their presence, and as you're in their presence, you're baptizing. You know, you're doing, you're revealing. Right? So each one of these is then, of course, the natures of the Godhead. Pater, or pater, depending on how you say it, is the word that literally means father. It's the Greek word that means father. And it's the most natural one used throughout Scripture. Son is the huios. You've heard that word before.
Yes.
The Greek word huios, which means a son by origin, a son by birth. I have the nature and characteristics of the father who gave birth to me. I know it sounds like I shouldn't say that, I should say mother. The reality is, huios means a son that looks like what he came from. And that's why he's a son, because he has the nature of the one who gave him seed. Okay? So, we're baptizing them, and we could go on and preach sermons about what does it mean to be baptized in the Father. And what those natures are, what the characteristics are. We could do that, but I don't want to. We could talk about the Son and what those characteristics, then we could talk about the Holy Pneuma. Holy Spirit, the very breath of God, the one that is now here among us, filling us, helping us to become everything that we were created to be. So, to finish this up, we're to be baptizing in the name and the knowledge and the understanding of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, want to keep doing this? There's a period there. Oh, is there a period? No, it's common.
Yeah.
Still common.
But it's still 20.
Yep. Teaching them. You all right? Teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. This is where we get back to what August was saying earlier. What did Jesus command them? All that I commanded you. Didn't he sum up all of the commands in a pretty simple command? Didn't someone ask him, hey, can you help me out here? We've spent our whole lives memorizing all these commands of Moses. What do you think is the greatest? And then he actually said, all of these commands that you've learned are based on these two.
Mm-hmm.
If you master these two, you master them all.
Yeah, that's right.
That's what he's saying. So, this is the beautiful part about this. As we go in this authority, making disciples, learners, understood, scholars of these identities, this is what they're learning. They're learning to love. As I've taught you to love, you teach them how. And what is by far the easiest way to teach somebody how to love?
To love them.
Do you see how easy this is?
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to have big conferences with big baptismals somewhere and big speakers that teach on all these different subjects and make sure everybody's got, okay, we've got apostolic covered and we've got prophetic covered and we've got prayer tents and all this stuff. You know what? Just go be you and love. Everywhere there should be a Christian conference every day, everywhere you go.
Yes.
We're walking Christian baptismals. We're walking Father, Son, Holy Spirit, love-making machines. Oh, Jesus.
Not sharing.
Not tweeting that.
So people are so immersed in like the Tenth Commandment.
Oh, yeah.
You know, if you tell them it's all covered in those things.
Right on.
It's almost like breaking rock with a chisel. You can't.
Yes.
Yeah. I had two of my neighbors last week saying, you should come out. I wanted to sew this for the, but you can't sew on Sunday. And I'm thinking, they're both lighting the smoke, the cigarettes. I started to say, you ain't supposed to light a fire either. That would have caused havoc, so I left it alone. But it's
come on.
I don't want to get this
even to the end of the age. So get this. He starts out with telling them, guys, I got this. That's basically what he's saying here. So whenever one of my children look at me and are like a little wondering, all they have to do is look at me and I say, I got this. It's good. Don't worry. You can do this because I got this. That's what he says here. All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. And then he tells us what we're going to do. We're going to go. And because we have all authority in Him, we get to go. And we get to make other people learn like we've learned. So actually, we never stop being disciples.
Right.
So all we do is we just cause other people to come into the same learning capsule that we're in.
Yeah.
There's no over-under here.
Right.
Come join me in this crazy adventure of being a son and daughter of God. This is awesome! Come join me!
Yeah, cool.
That's really all it is. And then, while we're doing that, how we convince them is we immerse them in Daddy and His Son and their Spirit. And look, here's the thing. We get to do it in love. And then he goes ahead, he just puts the other book in. Bam, right on the other end of it. And I'm always with you. Yeah, me, the one who has all authority. The one who got it all for you, will always have it. No one's taking it from me again, and He's definitely not taking it from you again. And I'm always going to be with you. So, you know what? You can't lose.
Yeah.
It won't fail.
Yeah.
This is the one time. I know people have said, oh, good, it's okay to fail. Oh, yeah, I've learned a lot from failure. I've said all these things. This is no failure. Mm-hmm. There is no failure. You cannot fail in this.
True.
If you do this, He does this, and we win. Every time. Anything else you do, possibility of failure. This, nope. I can guarantee you, I can stamp it, quote me on Twitter, whatever you want. You won't fail. Mark, I've been with people, and they don't listen to me when I talk to them. Have you done it like this? Now look, some people didn't listen to Jesus either. That doesn't mean you're failing.
Right, sure.
Is it? You see, we have this idea of I put in a certain amount of work and I get a certain amount of return. Okay? We have our mindset about when I do something, I get something. Okay? When Jesus died and said it was finished, how many did He have?
Not many.
All of
them. I'm not even sure you could say naturally He had His own disciples.
Nobody.
Because they all scattered. Strike the shepherd.
Nobody.
And they're scattered. What did you hear Aaron Roach just say though? Anybody hear him?
All.
He had them all. In his mind, though no one was with him, he had them all. Because he set them free. He set them all free. So, here's the deal. You go into your work environment tomorrow, or you go into your class, or wherever it is you go tomorrow, and you got to realize they're already all free. They just don't know they are. It's true. Okay. So, we used to walk around thinking to ourselves, these chains were around. Jeremy, come on. Am I the only one that ever pictured when they say he broke my chains? It was because they're wrapped around our ankles or our wrists. Have you ever seen it that way? Do you realize now that that's not the case? Here's the case. We're holding the chains. People hold broken chains.
That's true.
These chains are already broken.
Yeah.
We go into every one of our environments realizing that people are holding broken chains. We're not trying to break the enemy's hold off of them. Yeah. We're trying to break their hold off of what they think.
Yes. Very much so. Yes.
That's a total change.
Yeah.
When you realize you're not there trying to stomp on someone's chain. Get off of him. He's free. No. You talk to them.
Yes.
Do you know who you are? Do you know what's been done on your behalf? Do you know how he made you and he already set you free? You can let it go. It's not yours.
Yeah.
That's preaching. That's not even teaching anymore. Go ahead. Somebody's got their hand over there.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, I'm thinking, well, the more that you're walking in your discipleship and who you are, and your environment, it calls for them. It's not you doing to them, you immersing them. It's them actually choosing to immerse themselves. Yeah? I mean, I'm thinking, like, if you're walking in your sonship and you're being moved with you're walking your identity, your forgiveness and everything, it actually calls for people around you to step up to do that. So I'm thinking you're not necessarily doing it for them.
You're being it.
Right. They're choosing to immerse. They're choosing to baptize themselves.
You're being the Liberty Bell, the Freedom Bell says, dude, you're free!
Yeah.
Right.
Some people say, no, I like these better.
Right.
Just like in John 3, 17 and 18. They loved their darkness. Though the light was in right in front of them.
Yeah.
Light comes and says, you're free. Just imagine liking your darkness better than the light Jesus offers. That's exactly what's going on.
But it's much better, because someone can tell you all day long who you are. But it's when you make the choice to believe it for yourself that empowers you.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Allowing the authority.
Perfect.
Mark? So in the song that we sing, it says, break every chain. I can't remember like all the words, but when we're singing that, I don't remember the words, but we're saying break every chain. Are we talking about us breaking our own chains? I'm not mean to be picky. I do not remember
not
the
that.
Words.
Huh? Disclaimer, we did not write that.
No, I'm not being picky. I'm just kind of...
I think there's a lot of worship songs that sing about an unfinished work of the Lord.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't think that we have a full understanding all the time of the finished work of Jesus, so we write songs that help to explain our current reality.
Yes.
So when we're walking around chained, bound, thinking we're chained, it sure makes a heck of a lot of sense to say, break every chain, break, because we want those broken off of our lives.
By somebody else.
Right. So it's not so much God break these chains, it's like you decide, take a hammer and you break that link.
I just think it's this.
Chain. Is that what?
I honestly think it's this.
It's a finished move.
Yeah.
Now, if you do this long enough and you hold on to those chains, I believe they begin to wrap themselves around you. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
No,
they like their footholds and they don't like to let go.
Right.
Okay? But if you do this first, it cannot stay. Now, if I come along and I rip them off of you, but you never do this, you'll feel some of the relief here. But if you don't do this, they'll slowly start wrapping themselves right back up. And we see that so much in people's lives.
Yeah.
Yep.
Joey.
Well, Chris, together, too, when we were singing that song, that there's a pile of chains shredded in front of them, and they're actually kneeling down and taking the pieces, trying to put them back together. You know?
It's because it's their normal. It's all they know.
Yeah.
It's who they are is laying in ruins on the ground.
Yeah.
And because we're not baptizing them in this name, they think, oh my gosh, that's my identity.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Got to make it back a part of who we are. That's why. That's why. I wonder how many of us are actually living this. If we were all living this, people would not look at broken chains and weep over them.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't want to because they're swimming in Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Instead, we're going around saying, poof, get saved! Big, dug, ugly sinner. Instead of this, when you start to see this for what it really says, all of a sudden you realize, most of my preaching is just garbage. Most of what I've told people my whole life is ridiculous. If I just love them and be what August just described, then they have the opportunity to say, yes, I'm coming, or I like these better. Mm-hmm. That's my only responsibility. What do you think? Joey.
So it's not really chains, it's like a Chinese finger trap.
I love it. So we gotta change the words of that song. The Chinese finger trap! Break every Chinese finger trap!
You know you'll never
really do that. Explain that one to Denver.
Yeah, right.
So my thought is that for a really long time, what we have called evangelism never really worked. Because we were trying to break something that was already broken, and we left them without something to hold on to. So, like, for instance, you come to me and you're like, okay, we have to break these, we have to get you set free. We have to, like, we have a 9 a.m. deliverance class you can go to for 4 weeks. You'll be fine when you're done. But when we don't give them the immersion, it's never, that's why they loop over their chains. Because we haven't given them something to hold on to.
Because that is filling the void.
Give them something
broken,
better.
Right?
If we don't give them something better, why wouldn't they fall back?
They don't know this.
Yeah, we got to fill the void. Is that what you said?
Yeah, I said, because that's what they were used to. Uh-huh. And when it's broken, then there's a void there. And they're like, oh my gosh, what do I do? And if you don't fill that with Holy Spirit and that immersion, then it's like, they're like,
absolutely.
They go back to what's familiar. Like,
and that's why spirits come back and say, hey boys, it's still open.
Yes.
Why don't you come with me? Let's make it worse than it was before.
At least they knew who they were then.
They understood that. Ethan.
Ecclesiastes 7, verse 29 talks about how we were always, I feel like you always talk about the donut, but I feel like we were all inherently had that God in us. But we've always sought out different things because we didn't know it was in there. And it says, well, leading up to it, he talks about how he hasn't seen any man on earth, one in a thousand, you know what I mean? He hasn't found any women, that is, that he can respect and whatnot, but that's beside the point. But he said in verse 29, he says, behold, I have found only this, that God made men upright, but they have sought out many devices.
Come on.
That's back in Ecclesiastes.
Yes.
Talking about this.
This has been the same message all along.
Ecclesiastes 7:29.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing that. Right there in the middle of Old Testament, Solomon brings some wisdom to us. There's another hand up. Yeah.
I was going to say it's also our job to see them as free. Because a lot of times when we're talking to be saved, we see them with chains around themselves and we tell them that. So it's our job to see them as free and completed in Jesus. We have to do that.
Yep. You have already been made complete. That's what Paul told us. Whew. You got a thought?
Yeah, I kept stewing over that, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Stewing. Getting?
Yeah.
You're funny, kind of.
Baptizing. Okay, so I'm going to take this literally because I had to look it up. But baptizing was your immersed, submerged, to make overwhelms. And then the name, I kept going back to, you tied it before to the Lord's Prayer.
Right.
Hallowed be your name. And that hallowed is that sanctified, made complete, kind of, you know, made free, but pure kind of, totally forgiven. And when you combine that with the name, then it's that character and authority of the Father, the Son who evidenced him, and the breath, Spirit that moves on the earth with him. So it's immersed in the authority and character of
all those guys.
The Father, the Son, and the Spirit.
Wow. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So
I'm thinking that when we baptize people now, wherever we do it, like, it shouldn't just be a couple of few people there, right? Because it takes everybody to immerse somebody. Like, if we're going to immerse somebody, like, you can't just immerse them.
Yeah.
And so I'm seeing a lot of people in the creek because this, it takes everybody.
I'm starting a new thing here, people. You all got to get wet now. That's true, though. If you think about the spirit of this verse and what Aaron just said, that matches.
That's true.
Other thoughts? Will anybody ever read this verse the same again?
No.
I hope not. So, what are we doing here?
We better get out and go.
Yeah, right. What are you doing here? Get out of here! No. Yeah, now you know what you're doing here.
We need to stop thinking go as in...
go across the water.
No, well, no. Go as in... we need to think like, when I leave here, I'm going. When I wake up, I'm going.
I'm always going.
At lunch, I'm going. Dinner, I'm going. Not like I'm going for a period and then I come back.
Yeah.
Like, we go all the time. Trip. Like, yeah.
Right.
I'm going Sunday through Saturday, not just Sunday. You know, we just need to change our thinking of what go looks like.
Yeah.
Going is a go is like is a verb. It's an action word.
Yeah.
You get up out of bed and you move your foot.
Yeah.
You are.
If you're
going,
moving, as always said, you're going. Yeah. If you're leaving your home, heck, even in your home. Leave your bedroom and go into your kid's bedroom as the other parent. You're going somewhere. And if you know, sometimes my children are of a different ethnos. Especially in the morning. Don't you act like you're not.
There's somewhere that I thought I was taught that go meant while you are going. Like it's an active.
Going and you're going.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Something.
I didn't really see that in the Greek word, but you're right. That I've heard it taught that way, too.
Well, and that disciples inherently suggests a rooted concept, doesn't it? Because if a disciple is constantly going...
Moving. Growing.
There would have to be a rooted element to that. How do I put that thought together? I just don't see a lot of vagrants happening here, or a lot of, like...
Tumbleweed?
Yeah.
Yeah.
One interaction can't make a disciple.
Yeah.
One interaction.
Right.
I think we're all good. I'm sorry. Diane is going, though, is that if you're not careful, then you are always going. You're always moving. There is no root.
Yeah.
There is no home. There is no base from which you go. And again, we have to put this into the whole of Scripture. And you realize that roots and base and home and a place from which you go and come back to is a very biblical thing. So, also the rootedness is obviously first in these three.
Right.
There's also a rootedness in one another. Is that what you're going?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we are the fullness together, but...
Well, I think it's more like it's a mindset of willingness to go. It doesn't mean I actually always have to be physically moving, but I'm always willing to
right.
go. You know, and, you know, with the Lord. So it's just, it's a being. It's really the going is a being.
Joe.
That's
what you said.
Instead of go, just be.
Yeah.
Same
yeah.
Be.
Wherever you are, be this. You know? I love this. Let's just remind ourselves of this again. Teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. So basically what he's saying is, make sure that they do what you do. And I command you to love, so make sure that they're loving as you love. And that you're loving as I've loved. Because you can't love because until I first loved you. And then, don't worry, I'll be with you to remind you. All the time. I just see success all over this. That is an absolutely I can't lose strategy.
Mark?
Yeah?
It seems like sometimes it seems like a lot of times people think that you have to hit and you have to affect as many totally people as you possibly can. And I think that there are times that it's appropriate where sometimes the Lord, you've got like those people, you spend time with and you come alongside with them and you give them quality relationships. Do you want to what I'm saying?
I think you can't baptize without that. Mm-hmm. How do you immerse someone in Father, Son, and Holy Spirit on a drive-by?
I don't think that you can.
Yeah, I don't think you can. No, I think it is a relational. This is a relational strategy to me. Yeah. You make disciples. Go back to your word. You know, it's just not like a factory stamp, stamp, stamp. No, I think making is a process by which we mature and grow. So yeah, I think it's a time spent there. Yeah. All right, we're good?
Well, I have a question, but only if you can answer it super crazy fast.
Crazy fast.
So we're sons, but as sons, we're also disciples, because disciples are ones who are learning.
Uh-huh.
Right? Is that right?
Sure.
Okay. So we're making disciples, and I'm trying to figure out how disciple and son go together. Does that make sense? Like, if we are making disciples, like, how do we awaken them to their sonship by constantly being their baptism?
Well, it's right in here. As a disciple grows in this baptism, okay, let's put these two together. One of the things that they're learning is their identity as sons and daughters. How are they doing that? Through being baptized in the Father and the Son. Father gives himself to sons. Son teaches sons how to be sons. Holy Spirit helps us to become what the Father and Son has made us to be.
Got it.
Yeah. We're out. Deuces.